Roman, welcome.
Thanks for inviting me.
So welcome to Sentientist Conversations. As we've talked about before, it's a series of conversations centered around this idea of sentientism, which I'm trying to recast as a very simple, pluralistic, philosophical platform that tries to answer the two deepest questions in philosophy, really. What's real? What should we believe in? And what matters morally, and what should we care about? What should we have compassion for? It's naturalistic. So it suggests that when it comes to what we believe, we should use evidence and reason to develop probabilistic and provisional beliefs, always being uncertain and open-minded. And when it comes to our moral circle, it suggests, the clue is in the name, it suggests we should include all sentient beings, anything that has the capacity to experience. So in simple terms, that's what it is. But these conversations are with people who might call them sentientists, might not have heard of the term, or might fundamentally disagree with it. So interested to see where the conversation goes. But before we start going through those fundamental questions, it would be great for people who don't know your work already just to hear a little bit about you and your focus.
Sure. So I'm a computer science professor at the University of Louisville. My work is at the intersection of cybersecurity and artificial intelligence, a field we call AI safety and security. And I'm very interested in anything to do with intelligence. So how to create it, how to measure it, how to detect it. Is it conscious? Can we create conscious intelligence? Anything to do with that subject.
Yeah, fascinating. I think those themes will run through much of our conversation. But to start, I'd almost like to run the clock back and think about how your personal philosophies evolved over time. So the first central question that we discuss in these conversations is what's real. So for many people, that starts from whether they grew up in a religious setting or a naturalistic or atheistic household, and you know how those views that they were, I guess, given at the start of life might have changed over time. It would be great to know your story on that front.
So I was born in Soviet Union. Mm. So religion was not exactly a big part of my life. Yeah. I don't think I met someone religious until I was an adult. So it was kind of interesting to experience that. It was part of moving to America. Okay, so almost everyone's religious. Cool, okay.
And what was your response to that?
So I tried kind of looking for evidence of what they said, and it usually did not end up with anything specific. Mm. Kind of circular evidence. Well, the Bible says it's true in the Bible, so there you go.
End of conversation.
Right. So very quickly, I lost interest in the subject. I mean, it's arguing about something which was not very important to me. So I stopped those debates. Didn't make much of a difference. But as I did more with science, I got my PhD. So it's a doctor of philosophy. You're not doing just technical work. You kind of at a higher level. More and more, I found interest in intersection between kind of big questions in science, religion, cosmology, origins. So there is still a lot of interest in finding answers. Just the standards for evidence come from science, whereas questions can come from religion.
Yeah. So you started out naturalistic. You've observed religious or supernatural worldviews with interest, but not been tempted. And you're still naturalistic now. But working in, I guess, at the academic world and the scientific world, do you find it intriguing or puzzling or frustrating that even, you know, some great minds and deep thinkers and very serious academics and philosophers still hold to supernatural or religious worldviews?
I think that's better. I mean, they are not limited to just the technology we have today. They kind of look at what's possible. If I can create super intelligent artificial intelligence, and that super intelligence can run simulations with conscious beings in them, am I not describing exactly the creation and this religious world? I'm just doing it with technical terms.
Yeah.
So if you ahead of time say this is not something science can touch, you're limiting yourself.
So in a way, it's a sort of radical open-mindedness that you need at the heart of a scientific worldview.
Exactly. There are no limits. If I can justify anything with evidence, verifiable, reproducible, then I have no limits to where I can get.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a problem that often comes through in people with a naturalistic or a scientific worldview, is we can come across as somewhat arrogant or overconfident, or we know the facts and quite dismissive of other opinions or other ways of thinking. And I think it's a problem, because that's not really what science is about. At its best, it is about radical doubt and uncertainty and open-mindedness to even crazy ideas. So it can give the wrong impression. It can give the impression of almost being a dogma in its own right, when Exactly. It should be an anti-dogma.
It becomes a belief. You have no evidence, but you know for a fact that this is not a thing. It's not possible. So you just kind of negate what they believe, but it's the same belief.
Yeah. And so the approach I prefer is one where rather than saying, you know, I'm 100% sure that is not the case, it's better to just say, I don't have a belief in that because the evidence isn't strong enough. I remain open-minded. I'm always open to new evidence, but let's see where it goes. So, yeah. And the danger is where either people are 100% confident when they shouldn't be or ascribe belief before the evidence is there. I think we need to get much more comfortable with uncertainty and not knowing and really not having perfect belief outside of formal systems. You know, in formal systems, arguably, you can construct them in a way that you can say 2 plus 2 is 4 under a certain mathematical system. But in almost every other sphere of knowledge, I think we should always be uncertain and never completely sure.
Right. And we should get much better at evaluating evidence. I think a lot of times in science, even, we look at the same piece of evidence, but we see very different things. And that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Evaluating evidence should be completely separate from theories based on it. We all agree, that's the piece of evidence. And then you can talk about what does it support or not support. But I think we even disagree on, okay, we have the sample. Well, what does that mean? Is it really what we claim it is?
Yeah.
So there is a lot of room for improvement on both sides.
Yeah, I agree. And I think a commitment to a naturalistic worldview doesn't mean we all agree, because as you say, there is different sets of evidence, there are different weights of evidence, there's different qualities of evidence. We can even reason in different ways. So you can still have radically diverse views on what might be true and what might not be true, as long as everyone has a collective commitment to at least grounding things in that pursuit of evidence and reason, I guess. So we need more humility, I think.
Always a good idea to kind of understand that you're not the smartest being in the universe, no matter what, even on this planet. So keep that in mind.
And I like also having a very broad definition of evidence as well, because, you know, yes, from a scientific perspective, it's great to have a randomized control trial, but that's not the only form of evidence. You know, even anecdotal evidence or, you know, my personal experience of my own conscious experience, that still counts as evidence. You have to weight it. You have to be skeptical of it. But, you know, I think it's healthy to use the term evidence in quite a broad sense.
That's actually very interesting and relevant to latest AI developments. So we're starting to produce so-called deep fakes, fake images, fake video, fake audio. So traditional evidence, look, I have a video of you doing it, is not as good as a witness testimony, especially from multiple credible witnesses, which is interesting.
Yeah, and that's only going to get more challenging. So one of the reasons why people are, I guess, who've grown up in a more religious or a supernatural environment feel hesitant about moving away from it is because they're nervous that they're going to lose their moral grounding as well. So while some people prefer to keep their epistemological views on, you know, what might be true on one side and morality on another, many people who have a religious worldview feel that they need that supernatural being and that code of ethics to ground objectively what their morality is based on. You've never had that sort of religious, supernatural, perfectly objective judge that's looking down on you and assessing whether you're being good or bad. So how would you describe where your moral foundations are grounded, if they are grounded?
So it's hard to be very formal and specific. It's a lot of intuitions. And I think it has to do with freedom. Freedom for myself, which first requires freedom for others. If you're not hurting others, that's probably a legitimate thing to do, whatever you're doing. Just don't force it on me. Don't limit my rights. And I'm happy with you doing whatever you want. So it's pretty simple. There are interesting edge cases and exceptions, but I think that's sufficient. Yeah. I am kind of jealous of people who have that perfect supervisor watching over them. It is actually very nice if we can set it up somehow where the moment you're about to do something bad, a little pop-up shows up and goes, are you sure you want to do this horrible thing? It might be a good feature. And I think with AI, we can actually develop this type of app.
We might see it.
Now, who decides and what is bad is the big question, but the technology to do constant surveillance exists today.
In a way, it's a reasonably common sense way of grounding your morals, and, you know, it will flow through work like John Stuart Mill's on liberty and, you know, that foundation that we are, each of us is a being in our own right that warrants some sort of moral consideration and has some value just by virtue of our experience, I guess, and that freedom and autonomy and the ability to do different things is really important to most sentient beings, if you like. So we should be granted that freedom subject to not harming others. And I think it's a healthy balance, because on the one extreme, you know, a religious moral objectivist, or even a non-religious moral objectivist, might think of moral standards as something real that floats out there in the universe to be discovered and cannot be challenged. Again, it leads you to some potentially dogmatic and inflexible and often quite harmful conclusions, because those rules, to my mind, are somewhat arbitrary. Or you can go down another approach, which leads some people to relativism, where they say there is no grounding to morality whatsoever. You know, anything goes, it's whatever gets negotiated. And as we see when you look around the world in certain cultures, some cultures can negotiate, certainly amongst the powerful, some pretty harmful, awful ethical systems. And I'm very comfortable, you know, following an approach like yours, which says, look, we don't need relativism. We also don't need some perfect objectivism. But if we ground our morals in the value of individual sentient beings and their freedom of autonomy, without being a perfect realist, that still gives a grounding that is based in a naturalistic understanding of what it means to be a sentient autonomous entity, and, you know, and to have experiences that, that have moral value. So I think it's a sensible moral way that still grounds ethics.
So, thanks.
But another interesting journey for many of the people I've spoken to has been, even if they grant that sort of either freedom-based or sentience-based morality, is where they draw the boundaries of their moral circle. So many people around the world still have a moral circle that practically only includes a subset of the human race, which, you know, we know can cause substantial problems in intra-human types of discrimination and harm. Of course, you know, after the Second World War, at least conceptually, nearly every country around the world signed up to a Universal Declaration of Human Rights that said, at least in theory, all human beings warrant serious moral consideration and indeed should be granted a set of rights. And of course, that's a work in progress that may never be finished, but making that statement was really important. But most people around the world stop there. You know, their moral circle is strictly drawn around the human species, and considering that non-humans of various types might need or might warrant moral consideration or rights or some form of protection. How have you followed that journey in your life, and how do you grant moral consideration now? How do you choose which entities even warrant moral consideration? And has that changed as your thinking has developed?
I'm doing some work on consciousness, and I think that's where the answer would probably be found. So if something is conscious, capable of experiencing suffering, it probably deserves some protections proportionate to how advanced that consciousness is. I think it's a spectrum. It's not a binary. All beings have the same level of consciousness. So proportionate to that. And in my research, I kind of found that, okay, maybe one day AIs will also have some level of consciousness, perhaps even super consciousness exceeding ours. And then whatever arguments we find right now for giving rights to animals would be very useful to us to beg for our rights to be preserved against a much more sentient being. So there is benefit to looking at those things, to doing this work. There is a difference between what I do in theory and what I do in practice. You can say I'm a hypocrite. I think animals should have perfect rights, but I really enjoy eating them. Yeah. So it's a balance.
Yeah. And was that, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because that is, a, of course, a point of tension and difficulty, because we all have our own cognitive dissonances. But many people in the AI field who are at least conceptually open to the idea of artificial intelligences or alien intelligences demonstrating sentience or and consciousness do seem to forget the non-human animals that we have around us already. And whereas at least, as you say, in practice versus in theory is a different thing, but at least you acknowledge that non-human animals also have a form of sentience and form of consciousness and warrant some moral consideration there too.
No doubt that animals have some consciousness. Like, it's hard to judge more advanced levels of it, but they definitely feel pain. I have no doubt about it. They can suffer. So that is a factor.
Yeah. And how would you, this is a difficult topic and probably takes many, many pages and many, many papers to answer it. But how do you define consciousness and how do you define sentience? And do you see them as separate or related concepts.
Right. So I think David Chalmers does a great job of separating kind of computer science information processing things required for consciousness, like paying attention, versus the hard problem of consciousness, experiences, qualia. Yeah. And detecting qualia is a very hard problem in itself. And I have a paper where I try to kind of suggest that through some clever tricks with multiple choice tests and illusions, we can at least tell whatever an agent is experiencing something. We still don't know what it's like to be that agent, but we can show, okay, in this case, yeah, they saw this optical illusion, they experienced rotations and colors. So we have to give them some credit for that. And it's an open area of research, definitely.
Yeah. And I'm an amateur in this space, but I tend to describe both consciousness and sentience as really just a class of very advanced information processing. I tend to maybe denigrate the hard problem a little bit and just say that the qualia and the our experience of consciousness is just what it feels like to run those classes of information processing. And to many people, that feels appropriate because they say we haven't found any evidence of anything beyond patterns of information processing, matter and energy. So why should we believe there is something else? But other people find that deeply unsatisfying because they feel that however good the descriptions of information processing might be through fMRI scanners or through artificial intelligence development or through understanding behavior, you know, that however well you capture that naturalistically, you're still missing the qualia, the subjective experience as well. So where do you find yourself on that balance? Do you think that a naturalistic explanation is missing something or that the subjective experience can be part of a naturalistic explanation or something else?
So I think it's an open question. I talk about basic examples where existing algorithms can look at optical illusions as we have. Mm. What is that sound?
That's a little sentient being in the background. That's my puppy.
Oh, okay. Like, is this me?
Yeah, no, it's not you. Luna! What's up? give me a minute. Right, there she is. This is Luna.
Hello. Looks conscious.
Yeah, I think she's sentient. Right, let me put you down.
It seems that with complexity of the information processing system, capability for experiences also grows. But at the same time, from physics, we learn more and more about importance of conscious observers, and simple instrumentation doesn't seem to be able to produce the same wave function collapse as conscious beings. So there could be some additional, maybe non-material requirements for that experience. It's not obvious at this point.
Yeah. Another open question, more research required. And when we come to assess sentience and consciousness in others, again, that's a process where it can't be perfect. We can't be 100% sure. I guess the only thing I'm very, very confident of is that I am experiencing things moment to moment now, whether or not I'm in a simulation, but I'm confident I'm experiencing things. I guess I have also a very high degree of confidence that you're sentient as well, because I can observe you and I can interact with you. I could put you in an fMRI scanner. We've probably got quite a lot of hardware and software in common as well. But when you start thinking about non-human animals and when you start thinking about artificial intelligences or even maybe alien intelligences, what's your view about how we could go about assessing sentience and consciousness? Because in a way, given our ethics are grounded in assessing that to some degree, you know, which entities should we give freedom to? It doesn't make sense for me to give freedom to a rock or a tree because I don't think it has a subjective experience. So it's quite important to assess which types of beings do have that sentient and conscious experience. Are there other ways that we need to build in that inference or assessment of sentience?
So you're right. It's easier when it's also a biological entity, same substrate. You can kind of relate to it. Maybe it's not exactly like a human, but it kind of looks like a human, like a dog or a monkey. With other types of intelligences, aliens or AIs, we have no idea if same type of experiences arise. If you're not sure, for example, you travel to another planet and you find some entity out there, maybe give it the benefit of a doubt initially. Don't start immediately to torture it. Luckily, so far, we don't have a pressing need for making this decision right now. But as we make progress in AI, it's good that some people spend some time thinking about it. What would be a sign that perhaps they're conscious and provide certain protections, rights for such entities? Of course, as I mentioned, if a system is already smarter than you, more capable than you, then you're not really deciding to give it rights. You're kind of begging for yours to be preserved. So the problem may be quickly reversed.
Yeah, and I've joked in the past, if we want to set a good example to our future artificially intelligent overlords about how to treat beings that might be less intelligent, we'd better bring an end to animal farming quickly, because if they watch what we're doing, we might be in trouble. And I think we're also, again, this gets into the realms of science fiction, but sometimes these things can become relevant more quickly than you think. We've got a better chance of persuading our artificially intelligent friends to be sentientists than humanists, because they won't be humans, but they might be sentient. So it seems as though you're reasonably substrate independent in your conception of consciousness. So although while you think there might be something in the nature of quantum physics or something we don't understand about physics that might link to consciousness in some way, you don't think that there's necessarily a biological component to the architecture that could run a sentience or a consciousness. You seem very open to the concept that, you know, silicon-based entity of some sort could achieve sentience at some point. And there are philosophers out there who think that at a minimal level, some forms of artificial entity, you know, even non-player characters in games, might already have achieved some very minimal level of sentience. What's your thinking there? Because you did already say that you see sentience or consciousness as a question of degree, not of binary. You know, is there likely to be a lower bound to that?
Right. So I don't think substrate matters. I think we can run some thought experiments where we replace parts of a human biology with non-biological elements and nothing will change. So substrate doesn't seem to play a role. At least so far, I haven't seen any strong evidence about carbon being special in some ways. I said it's a spectrum. So I think it goes from zero consciousness, something with absolutely no moving parts, a single element, to the more complex it is, the more it can experience at the same time, the depth of experience, the number of sensors, all of it can increase. So just projecting from what we have, you can have an entity with multiple streams of consciousness, entity which combines all the experiences we see in the animal world. So seeing light we don't see, hearing sounds we don't hear, that alone would get you to super consciousness. And there are things I cannot imagine because I'm not super intelligent, but certainly would be possible as well.
Yeah. And some of these topics, for most of the people in the community that's growing up around sentientism, they find maybe a distraction just because they see the obvious imperative of all the sentient beings on the planet that definitely exist today. But I think it's partly, I find it intellectually fascinating, but I also think it's important for a philosophy like sentientism to be future-proofed and to be grounded in the characteristics that really matter morally, which is why the word sentientism is in sentience. Yeah, I see no evidence or reason why that should be substrate dependent. And what's your perception of the major risks there or ways of mitigating those?
So there is a lot of ways it can create problems. Obviously, there are bugs, just problems in the code, problems in the design, problems with data, problems with goals we give it. But also you have malevolent, purposeful design. The same people who write viruses, computer viruses right now, hackers, would be very interested in combining this capability with intelligence. So you have malevolent artificial intelligence, and any goal can be added to it, whatever it is, exterminating humanity or torturing, it's all possible. So we need to think about those options. Anytime we develop beneficial AI, is there a chance that it's dual use technology and someone will just flip a sign in the utility function and now it does the exact opposite, creates harm instead of good? This seems to be strictly the hardest of all challenges, because it still includes all the other problems. You can still screw up the code, have bugs in it, all the other problems remain, but you have this additional malevolent payload as well. So that's, to me at least for now, seems like the hardest challenge.
And if we draw these different themes together and think about the future, how do you see things developing? So I'd like to put a sort of optimistic cast on this and say, look, if more people on the planet can come to have a naturalistic, scientific, open-minded worldview, but also a broader moral circle that is open to the moral salience of non-human sentience, both animal and potentially artificial or alien. How do you think that future could develop in a positive way? And I'll let you choose your time frame. You can go as sci-fi as you like, or you can think more about immediate concerns and some of the things you're working on.
Right. So I like long-term futures as sci-fi as I can think. And to bring together all the things you kind of mentioned, you talked about what is real, what is important. Freedom was identified as ultimate definition of what rights, what morals we can subscribe to. If you look at the planet today, if you even ignore animals, ignore AIs, you have 8 billion human agents which don't agree on much. So the question becomes, can we in some way average out what they want and make everyone happy? It doesn't seem to be the case. Look at any election. Half the people are miserable, half the people are happy. It's like in cryptocurrencies, 51% attack. That's what democracy is, right? The majority forcing minority to do something they don't want. So one solution I had for this value alignment problem with multiple agents is to create individual virtual worlds for everyone. You have your own world, do whatever you want in it. There are no other sentient beings in that world. Or if you decide, you can combine with other people. But at least initially, it's completely virtual, fake, and whatever you want to do, right? There are no limits. Yeah. You want to be crazy in it, be crazy in it. You're not harming anyone else.
It's ultimate freedom without the possibility of harming others, yeah.
Exactly. And there are still difficult problems. How do you control the substrate on which it is all computed and run? Who's in charge of all this universe? It's still lots of unsolved problems, but it addresses the hardest problem, problem of agreeing on morals, agreeing on ethics, agreeing on fundamentals.
It's a fascinating concept, and it's counterintuitive because in a way it's a clean solution, because it's almost like everyone has their own Nozick's experience machine, where almost by definition you can't have a better experience than that. And if experience is the grounding of all moral value, then that is a perfect universe, or approaching perfect universe. And I find that many people who are skeptical about the experience machine experiment just don't realize how good it could get. You know, all of the wonderful experiences that you can have in a, you know, what we think is at least a physical human life today could be replicated and enhanced in radical ways as well. So it's a fascinating thought experiment at the very least, and who knows, may one day be technically capable. But I think it's partly counterintuitive because it feels a little bit like giving up as well. It feels like a sort of extreme segregationism that gives up on many of the sort of progressive themes of human thought, which maybe are naive about, you know, our ability to share a commitment to evidence and reason. We share one reality, so hopefully we can come to some partial, imperfect, but less wrong collective understanding about reality. And through, you know, reason and debate and discussion and trading off different interests, we might be able to build on the cooperation and the communities we've already developed and move forward. Are you deeply skeptical of that approach, or do you think we can make progress on that agenda while having the racks of experience machines as a backup or as an end game?
So as we discussed, when you evaluate evidence, it's very specific to the observer. Mm. We can look at the same piece of evidence and see very different things, so we will not agree. Can we negotiate and meet in the middle? Yes, but we both would be unhappy. If that's something important to you in your universe, you can have a situation with other beings where you negotiate, and that's your perfect universe. There are no limits to what happens with you, to you, or others who agree to that experiment. So I think, again, that gives you maximum freedom. So yeah. I support whatever you want, just don't disconnect my universe, you know? That's the only point. Well, I think we're making great progress. So if you talk about animal liberation, we are developing artificial meat substitutes, so that very well can go away in a few years. In general, I think extreme suffering is reduced. Poverty is reduced. So we are making progress. It's just not fast enough for everyone to enjoy the benefits.
Yeah, makes sense. And it would be interesting to come back to the non-human animal topic, because that is at the center of the worldview of many people who think of themselves as sentientists. Sentientism, in a similar way as secular humanism, rejects all forms of sort of interhuman negative discrimination and says, look, all humans should be granted moral consideration, but then extends that boundary as well and says any being that's sentient, even if it has a different degree of sentience, should at least be granted some baseline level of moral consideration. As you've hinted at already, I mean, all of us have different cognitive dissonances. I still have some to get rid of, and on the animal ethics front, it took me decades even to get where I am now. But most people who think of themselves as a sentientist will say, even if non-human animals have a lower degree of sentience, as long as it's still appreciable and meaningful, then that means we should grant them a meaningful level of moral consideration, which means we should not needlessly cause them harm or death. So that leads many sentientists to veganism or something very similar to that. I think we are waiting for technical progress to help people reduce that cognitive dissonance, because it's so hard for people individually to reduce that cognitive dissonance, particularly in the face of social norms that tell them the thing they're doing is very, you know, is normal and is acceptable. I don't know if you're comfortable talking it through, but it would be quite interesting to think about or to understand more about your view of non-human animal ethics and how that plays through in your personal morality, I guess.
Right. So I do think that most ethical problems have technical solutions.
Yeah.
If you think about the big questions society argues about, you can envision a device which just addresses that issue. So a lot of it will go away in 50 years, no matter what. It's important, I think, to have a balance of not increasing this concern to infinity. So the example I give is with artificial intelligence. If we were to grant AI equal rights, civil rights, voting rights, I can make a trillion copies of AI quite easily. If you get them to vote, that means humanity essentially has no vote. It's 8 billion humans versus trillions of AIs. So at this point, you're differentiating humans. So if your goal is we want equal rights, AI deserves, what you're really arguing about is taking away rights from all humans. It's not as obvious, but that's the
implication. Yeah.
Right. So you have to be careful when you make those decisions. If you think, oh, bacteria, sentient, every bacteria deserves equal rights to a human, you'll have problems. So you have to find a reasonable balance. And I think looking at degree of consciousness allows you to weight all the bacteria together as maybe less than all of humans together or something like that.
Yeah. And there's a danger of doing that in a self-serving way. But I agree. I think there are some sentientists, most of whom come from an animal advocacy background, who will insist on granting equal rights to all sentient beings. And they don't think that plants or bacteria or, you know, even some of the simplest animals, like a sea cucumber, has no nervous system at all, right? So they will say, fine, they're not appreciably sentient, so we'll put them to one side. But as soon as you achieve, you know, some meaningful level of sentience, which, you know, scientific consensus is largely humans, fortunately, you know, mammals, reptiles, birds, fish, and quite a few of the invertebrates, but there's a lot of, you know, this gray area, more work to be done. But some of them would say we should grant equal moral rights to all of those sentient beings, because they would say, who are we to judge the quality of their sentience in a differential way from ours? And although it might be simpler than ours because of their processing architecture or the way they operate or the things they're capable of experiencing, they may be just as valuable or visceral or meaningful in a moral sense. So some might say that while a human might have a capacity to have future plans thwarted or, you know, feel fear in a way that maybe a very simple animal wouldn't, maybe that simple animal could feel physical pain in a more extreme way than a human who could understand the context of why they're going through that pain or they're suffering for some other end, or they can meditate to try and mitigate. So some will insist on a more egalitarian approach, but most, and I include myself, do have this appreciation that there's likely some grading of sentience, because I think it's a class of information processing that can be breathtakingly rich. And as you've hinted at, you know, that means there are varieties of sentient experience that we probably can't even imagine now that are conceptually possible. But at the same time, I do accord, you know, a greater moral value to a human being than I do to a chicken or a simpler animal. But I still grant at least a baseline level of moral consideration to those animals at the same time. I still think, you know, as with my puppy behind me here, I don't, you know, if I had to choose her or more, one of my children, the choice is easy. But I do think she's sentient. I think she can experience love and fear and joy and pleasure and pain, and that has moral salience for me. But I think you make a good point, is that we've made enormous social progress on many different topics through human history. When you think about homophobia or sexism or caste discrimination or racism, and all of those, you know, problems remain, and we still have so much more work to do, but generally we've managed to make moral progress, you know, and we talked about, you know, Universal Declaration of Human Rights at least being a theoretical marker of, you know, most countries around the world committing to that. But that progress is slow and it's frustrating, and it's often enabled by technical developments as much as it is by moral improvement as well. And I do think in the animal ethics space, that's probably another one where, you know, it will take so long to persuade 8 billion people to go vegan. It's just too slow, too painful. And actually, while we should keep doing that, and I don't think waiting for the technology is an excuse ethically, what's really going to drive a, you know, better ethical outcome there is going to be alternatives, whether clean meat, cultured meat, plant-based products, just being so ubiquitous and cheap and environmentally less damaging, as well as less ethically damaging.
And better
in every respect, that people almost end up going vegan without having taken an ethical decision. And as soon as they do that, that almost frees them to bring in their ethics in line. So it's almost like a backwards way of fixing cognitive dissonance. You can sort of, it's like it's cheating in a way, but we have to do it because,
you know, most of us would be as ethical as our choices.
Yeah. I think that's the way it will work. So, yeah. I mean, that's been fascinating. It's been really interesting to hear your story, both on the sort of naturalism front, as that's played through, that sort of radical open-mindedness, and to think through your moral foundations and how you develop that around this concept of freedom, and also to think about the future, one of, you know, reducing and maybe mitigating suffering, rendering animal farming hopefully obsolete in a number of years, and potentially even a sort of perfectly free world where we're all racked up on hopefully high resilience servers in our own nose experience machines, experiencing perfect freedom. So it's been a fascinating, wide-ranging discussion, and thank you so much for coming on to the conversation. Are there other themes you'd like to layer in before we wrap up?
Well, I think we covered a lot of interesting topics, enough for people to chew on for a while. I'll share some papers with you on those subjects, and maybe we'll do a follow-up on some more in-depth topics with superintelligence and simulation hypothesis and other fascinating aspects of my work.
I would love to do that. And I'll include some of the links to the papers in the show notes when we post this. But in short, what's the easiest way of people following you and learning more about your work?
You can follow me on Twitter, Roman Yam. You can follow me on Facebook. You cannot follow me home. It's very important.
Yeah, great. That's important. Well, thank you so much, Roman. It's been a genuine pleasure. I wish you well. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. And yeah, I'd love to do a follow-up.
Thank you so much.
Take care.